Please.
In Sri Ramakrishna's evening arati from Khandana Bhava, towards the end he is praised as Hara, as Shiva. So, would you want to comment on that?
Well, yes, actually, that arati singing in Ramakrishna Math, originally only that what is still now chanted and traditionally maybe for many centuries at that Kashi Vishwanath temple, Jaya Shiva Omkara, Bhaja Shiva Omkara, so that was recited at Belur Math also. So when Swami Vivekananda composed the arati song, he wanted to include an element of that also in this. So he saw Sri Ramakrishna there as Lord Shiva, that it is Jaya Jaya Arati Tumar, Shiva Shiva Arati Tumar, Hara Hara Arati Tumar. So Hara Hara, that Shiva Shiva. So that is, and therefore that particular part, it begins with the sound of that mridangam that is accompanied with the Shiva songs, de langa, ranga, bhanga, these are that sounds of the mridanga, and then all the devotees are singing your praises. And Jaya Jaya Arati Tumar, Har Har Arati Tumar, Shiva Shiva Arati Tumar. It is to preserve that element of the original Arati and also to see Sri Ramakrishna as embodiment of Shiva.
I guess maybe I missed this. You might have already said. So if you break Om, then there are three parts, and I missed what each they represent. What it represents of the three parts.
Well, three parts. It gets separated without getting separated. It is. So the three aspects of existence are described by the separate letters A, U, Ma. A represents the state of wakefulness. Represents the state of dream, and then Ma represents state of deep sleep. It also represents creation, sustenance and dissolution. It also represents the gross body, subtle body and the causal body. So it gets trifurcated as these three, or sattva, rajas, tamas. And Om as a whole transcends all these divisions. It has all and yet it is beyond all.
In that verse, first verse, I think the first verse of this class, this session, we had that connection between the action and the result.
Yes, yes.
And we attributed only when the success was there in the result as God being present as a connection.
Yeah.
Why not in the failure time also?
What? Oh, the failure
because
time.
Lord karma, if you think, is more like an action and the result.
Action.
That's
and
very general view.
Yeah.
But here we are being very specific.
So exactly, this is an aspect of action which is not clearly seen, and therefore I gave the example of glue that holds the pieces of furniture together. When you see the whole furniture, you do not see glue, but it is that which holds the different parts together. So this glue is that aspect of the divine which connects the various things in the work and the result. So when that glue and other parts also are present, then alone the desired result of an action comes. It is, if that is not there, then the other aspects present yet are not sufficient to yield the desired result.
Can we say that at that point the divine will was not with us at that point? We were probably doing it more of our own ego or will. But
that is true. One can say like that, that it is done without the blessings of the divine. So that was how it did not bear the proper, the expected results. That give it to Kunal Da. His hand was raised first.
Directly as a follow-up of what Srikant asked, that was my question too in the beginning, that God is like a glue, but whatever happened to this other rigid rules of karma, which I thought was like a machine, you do this, 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 and the output comes up. Where is God in any of this?
Yeah, it is a very intriguing question indeed, that it is that the connector of this, the rule is very rigid, but you know the use of this word rule also involves the maker of the rule. So when you respect a rule, you are respecting the maker of the rule. If you don't respect, the rule also does not stand then. It is one important ingredient is being neglected in that bringing together various components. Because that ingredient was not visible, it was not thought to be required, but it is required. So if you don't respect that, the results may not come.
This one, Maharaj, I will have other things on this particular issue later on. I hope I can talk to you. The other two related to this one was, you said Shiva is responsible for making this connection. We used to think that Vishnu is Brahma creates this, which we talked about later on. But then Shiva, since when did he become also the glue stuffer?
See, this is how you will see the Indian mythologies or the epics and the Puranas. It is the whatever deity they are describing is the supreme deity in anything. Read Durga Saptashati, the Chandi, everything is Divine Mother. Tvam Swaha, Tvam Swadha, Tvam Shri, Tvam Ri, everything is She. It is, if you read that Ganapati, Ganesha, chant that Ganesha Atharva Shirsham, everything is Ganesha there. Recite the Narayana Suktam, it is Narayana, everything is Narayana. That Narayana Upanishad, Brahma Narayana, Shiva Narayana, and all, everything is, this Om is Narayana. So the idea is you can take anyone, but feel the existence of all in it. And that is the idea in realizing God, that you take up any aspect, you can start, say, with the worship of whatever your, say, deity in the family, that, okay, we will worship Renuka Devi. So you start worshipping that. Gradually, because of that worship, the deity, you attribute everything to it. Because of her blessings, I am getting everything. So it is, all the things are attributed to that. The Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh, everything is contained in that. So everything is worship by worshipping that deity. So we also, you know, while doing worship to Sri Ramakrishna, do you worship sometimes here?
Yeah.
Worship to Sri Ramakrishna.
Yes.
The mantra used for that is Om Aing Sarva Deva Devi Swarupaya Sri Ramakrishnaya Namaha. So all different aspects of deities are included in that. So this is how there is thus no fight between Shiva and Vishnu, except that those who become fanatic, there is that, therefore the different movies, there was in South India, the followers of the Shiva sect, and they said that Ramayana movie should be banned. It is terrible. Shiva is shown to salute Rama. How could that happen? Eh? It is that Ramayana serial has to be banned completely. And those then that the Shiva Purana, another serial, the serial makers, they don't have particular love for any of these. They want to make some nice popular series.
And money.
That is, you don't talk about it, okay. That is, but make money, you are right. So it is, so it was projected there that Shiva Purana, that all these Vishnu and all, they are praying to Lord Shiva. So those Vaishnavites became terribly upset, how can this happen? So it is because they fight with each other. They don't like their deity to be subservient to any other deity. So, but when you see that it is the same one reality is being worshipped through various different forms. Some likes one form, some likes some other form. You know, it is like that. Somebody likes to eat sandesh. Some likes to eat that very thing, you know, in different form. We will make it in as chum chum. So same chana is made into chum chum, and we will eat it as chum chum. So the ingredients are same. So if you want one form, okay, take this. It is the jalebi, but you want, you know, that give it another form, the same substance. You give it a more decorative form instead of all those just strings, you call it imarati, okay, eat it. So it is whatever, the Shiva is not liked by many, this form that looks ugly basically. No, we don't want to worship that. Let us worship Mother Durga. It is, see how many nice ornaments and then rides, lion, great. Oh, Kali thi, na, never worship Kali. It is, see, dark and has again skulls around her neck and horrible looking, you know, that skull, bleeding skull, the blood is still dropping from it. Is it to be worshipped by human beings? No. Earlier days, those cannibals and all, they were worshipping that, you know. It is not to be worshipped. Tamasika. So, but look at that, you know, all these great sages, they worshipped Kali. So it is, whatever you think, take it one and that gets everything in it.
Thank you, Maharaj. And I just want, this is not a question, I wanted to mention that you, the first day you mentioned, this Shloka 32 where Asitya Girishamam,
yeah,
etc., was the one that Sri Ramakrishna was,
yeah,
chanting and went into Samadhi.
Yeah,
and
yeah, correct, yes. Here he has a question too. And Atreya had one question, yeah.
Shami.
Maharaj, too, one is a comment, but nothing to do with the talk about today. But Joan was not only right in 2000, but he also right in 2016. Just wanted to know that. Just wanted to check with you, Maharaj. You mentioned in the beginning of the talk, I don't know, you might have talked about it, I might have missed it, about Kashmiri Shaivism, that you wanted to make any comments on that.
Well, Kashmiri Shaivism, it is a great spiritual discipline that was organized, formalized, especially in Kashmir, and then it gave rise to these very important spiritually illuminating texts like Shiva Sutras and the various commentaries on that, Spandakarika, this is Kashmiri Shaivism and many offshoots of that. Like Natha Sampradaya is a direct offshoot of Kashmiri Shaivism, of which again some great saints in Maharashtra were initiated in that, like Jnaneshwar. He was initiated into this Natha Sampradaya. So it is. They are all from this Kashmiri Shaivism. So Kashmiri Shaivism, it is a little different from some this as that sects of that worship Shiva, but not as the non-dual reality. They worship Shiva as like the dualist would worship, with great devotion. But all dualists, by the very constitution, are fanatic. So they become fanatic. Kashmiri Shaivites, being non-dualists basically, they have no fight with anyone. But the dualist Shaivites get into fight with dualist Vaishnavites. So, yeah, my Shiva is greater or Vishnu is greater? And Sri Ramakrishna would say that that Shiva and Vishnu, their fight was, their differences was put to rest in no time. But the between the followers, that the monkeys of Rama and these demons of Shiva, their fight continues to this day, you see. It is the players between the two different clubs, they change, you know, whether it is Red Sox or New York Yankees, and they don't have any fight, you see. And they change, you know, it is okay, this club is giving me better things, money, so I change from Red Sox to Yankees. It is, but the followers, they are diehard. So that is how the worshippers of a particular deity, if they do not get this non-dual foundation, then they automatically tend to be fanatic. Because at that stage, my devotion to this deity means my hating other deities, you know. It is like my patriotism for my country means hating other countries, they are bad, you see. So it is, but with the non-dual foundation, this does not tend to occur. Yes.
So you said, as I understood, anahata is a conception of the sound, not actually any sound, but in many places it is said it is heard in meditation.
Yeah.
But if it is heard, then it already gets some qualities.
Not heard by these ears, therefore.
Is the source is internal, that's it.
The source is deep internal, and therefore it is, it transcends these the particular varieties of sound. It is heard, therefore again one should not get hung up on this word heard and connect it to our way of hearing. It is heard means you get attuned to that reality, and there you see that reality in the sound form also. It is just as the visual aspect of it is different from what we see. It is God gets seen, and should not be interpreted like I see you or you see me. It is not it is a visual aspect of that all-pervading reality. And similarly, there is the sound aspect to it, which is again all-pervading. Just as that cannot be seen with these eyes, it is like that Meister Eckhart saying, you can't see God. You can see God, but not with these eyes. You, what eyes? You have to use the eyes with which God sees you and to see God. The eyes with which God sees you, and those eyes can see God.
But there is some other variations, not necessarily the variations that we see here, but there is some other qualities of sound at that
level.
No, at least not mentioned. Therefore, if you ask those who later on said, well, they heard anahata dvani, okay, please try to make it. They never made that sound for our benefit. It cannot be sounded like that. So it is the substratum of all sounds. There is no hitting together. It is not two objects striking. So it is not a variety. There is something that is very close to it, which is called Pashyanti, a level where there is the knowledge of reality and the reality manifesting in the seed form with all these. Now, there is a level of distinction there, and there is the sound distinction associated with it. But again, that is not the unstruck sound, but these very subtle, fine forms, and they are striking each other. It is like you think of it, you know, you see in the dream a truck moving along, and the truck will make a sound that will be a dream sound, and that will not be heard by your gross ears, but will be heard by you in dream. If the dream is broken, you will not be able to hear that sound. So, and the others may be awake when you are sleeping and dreaming, they will not be able to hear any sound or any truck, so will not be able to see that. Now, Pashyanti is still a finer, subtle level. Now, there again, because of variety, there would be the hitting of the objects. that would be creating a sound of the Paschanti level, which would be heard at Paschanti level itself. But it is again an Ahata sound. It is para, that is identified with Anahata dhvani. So there is no variety and so no striking. So that is, now when somebody gets to that level of awareness, then one actually hears that Anahata dhvani. Otherwise, when people say that they heard the Anahata dhvani, it is to be understood in the relative sense that they heard at a very subtle level that sound which was not, others were not able to hear. So, but that is only by extension it is called Anahata. It is really Ahata, but called Anahata because of the, that transcendence of this level of Ahata. Yeah. Oh, he has a question.
I don't know if this is too long of a topic potentially now, but I have trouble thinking about karma in a non-dual way. To think of cause and effect, and if we attribute lordship as a connector,
yeah,
then I get back to thinking of a cosmic banker and credits and debits,
yeah, yeah,
in the universe.
Yeah, yeah.
And a non-dual understanding escapes.
None of these are present at the non-dual level. But non-dual level is present in all of them. It is like you make from clay various pots. Now clay is present in all these pots. And in a transcendental sense, these pots also are present in the clay. Otherwise, how could you take it out from clay? So, the cause and effect relationship is not present in the non-dual aspect. There is no cause, no karma, no effect. All are one. But when it manifests as one of them, the others also come together. If there is an action, then the effect of action and that which connects them. Now all these three have come from that same reality. If you think of this, that suppose a pot and a potter, they are both carved out of clay. Now they are still clay, and yet there is a pot and a potter, and the potter making the pot. So now if you take out the clay from there, nothing will survive. So the effect and the action and its effect, they both are connected through this aspect of oneness that comes from this non-dual reality. That non-dual, that reality is same in both, and that is why they are connected. That is why a particular action leads to the exactly same result, because there is this connector that brings them together. So that is, yeah, it is like the lock and key in a relationship. So, but somebody who has made the lock and key has kept that connection. So that is how action and the result that accrues from the action, that is there. So many, many thanks, friends, for this retreat. It is a very difficult topic in a way, but I tried my best, as difficult to elucidate, and the Sanskrit is not very easy Sanskrit, Moreover, the words were not properly, the syntax is not like a sentence, you have a syntax. Here in the poetry, one word in the beginning connects somewhere in the middle word. That is the license of a poet. So, and here Pushpadanta has used it very liberally. Even if you know the words, you will not see which particular word is related to the other word. You have to know some rules of grammar for that, rule of composition of a poetry, then you get the meaning. So it is, even the scholars of Sanskrit, they find it difficult to properly elucidate everything. But we are not into that, and we just wanted to meditate on Shiva and get the purifying effect of it. The purpose that the Pushpadanta composed this was let it be our purpose as well in reading and studying this, so that we will not understand it fully, but by trying to understand it, some purifying effect will come to us. Om Namah Shivaya Shantaya Karanatrayabhidhave Nivedayami Chatmanam Vamgati Paramesha.